35 drivers, 16 nationalities, 3 champions, 1 champion. Road to Indy TV.
What a morning it's been for the drivers here in this Road to Indy presented by Cooper Tires. A couple of tremendous victories. Christian Rasmussen, of course, his first triumph in USF 2000. Kyle Kirkwood coming back after the issues yesterday to get his third win of the season here in Indy Pro 2000. One more race still to come, of course. It's a three-rung ladder program as we send more and more drivers to the NTT IndyCar Series. Drivers on the grid right now getting set to go in Indy Lights. Just one step away. Last year, it was Colton Herta and Pato O'Ward. They were the two stars we watched race last year. 9 more drivers ready to go, each and every one of them trying to see if they cannot work their way, as we said, into the NTT IndyCar Series. Still about 4 minutes away before we fire up the engines here. And as we do with this ladder system, everything gets quicker, everything gets better. 170 horsepower in USF 2000, 280 in the Indy Pro, 450 horsepower here. More horsepower, more aerodynamics, more braking capability, more of everything here for Indy Lights. These cars, just tremendous training vehicles for the drivers trying to work their way into IndyCar. Let's have a look at the 9 drivers we have set to go here in the program. Starting in the 9th position, a rookie who jumped over the Indy Pro 2000 category after a couple years in USF 2000, the Brazilian Lucas Cole, the rookie in the number 5 for Ballardi Auto Racing, set to start in the number 9 position. Row number 4, a driver who was very good early on this weekend. Watch for him to work his way forward as well. A winner at Road America just a couple of weeks ago. Starting in the 8th position for Andretti Autosport, it'll be the number 48 of Ryan Norman. Norman out of Aurora, Ohio. Inside of that row, starting in the 7th position for BN Racing, a rookie who we've watched come through USF 2000 and Indy Pro. That's David Malukas from Chicago, Illinois, the number 79. He will start in the 7th position. Moving now to row number 3 on the outside, another driver who has won already this year. Rookie out of New York, New York for Andretti Autosports and the Palo Alto Network's number 27 machine, Robert McGinnis, starting in the 6th position. BN Racing came into this event with a clean sheet of paper. The first time they have come here as an Indy Lights operation, so they've been working throughout the weekend to try to dial in their setups. A good qualifying effort for Toby Sowery from England in the number 2 machine. He'll start on the inside of row number 3, P5. Moving now to row number 4. It's the only Canadian we have here in Indy Lights. What a qualifying run, folks. He's from nearby here in Toronto, up in Stouffville, but living now in Indianapolis. But he's a Canadian boy through and through, starting in the 4th position. Outside of row number 2, a round of applause for number 67, Dalton Kellett. Dalton Kellett for Andretti Autosport, rather for Juncos Racing. He'll start P4 in the K-Line Insulators, number 67. Great qualifying run for Dalton Kellett. Inside of row number 2, the driver who was able to win yesterday for Ballardi Auto Racing shook the rust off a little bit at Road America, but he came back strong. Aaron Tielitz from Rice Lake, Wisconsin, the number 4, the winner yesterday. He'll start today from the inside of row number 2. Drivers on the front row, a rivalry that has been brewing for a couple of years. They battled it out in USF 2000 2 years ago. Then they battled it out last year at Indy Pro. Both have won championships so far in Road to Indy competition. They're going to start on the front row, and they are the point leaders right now as well. Off pole in the number 21 machine for Juncos Racing, the sole red Mazda colors, last year's Indy Pro 2000 champion, the Dutch phenom Rinus VK, starting on the pole position in the number 21. But the driver on the pole position today, a couple of big wins this year already. One in Austin, Texas. He won at the Freedom 100 in the Index Invest Andretti Autosport number 28 out of Jupiter, Florida. Your pole sitter today, number 28, Oliver Askew. It'll be Askew and VK on row 1, Tielitz and Kellett on row number 2, Sowery and McGinnis on row 3, Malukas and Norman on row 4, and Cole on row number 5. We are about set to go here, ladies and gentlemen. Here we go to get things underway. One of my guests from Cooper Tires to give the command, Mr. Jonathan Thomas.
Thank you, Rob, and on behalf of everyone at Cooper Tires and the fine men and women who engineer and build the tires that you drive on today, drivers, start your engines.
And with that, the engines come to life down here on pit lane. Michael Young, it's time to go Indy Lights racing.
And we thank you, Rob Howden. We have a very special guest from Cooper Tires who will be waving the green flag here for the call of this Indy Lights race number 2 here on the streets of Toronto. We'll throw things over to Nick Yeoman and the IndyCar Radio Network.
Buffett concert. There's likely a few parrot heads still trying to get things going, knocking off the cobwebs here today. But certainly we're ready to go this morning as the drivers head west, a 2,400-foot drive down Lakeshore Boulevard before making a sharp right-hander in the turn number 3. About 110-degree right-hander, concrete walls to the right, filled up with Acura signage, and then a runoff area and tire barriers to the left, slightly uphill from there. It can be tricky, as certainly was several years ago. Things have smoothed a bit over time, though. It's a quick left, turn 4, setting up for turn 5. And really, I think the place to be is to driver's left if you want to complete a pass here, where they'll come to the view of the voice of the NTT IndyCar Series. We say good morning to Mark James. Hi, Mark.
Good morning, Dave. Thank you very much. Happy to be here on this sun-splashed day in beautiful Toronto. Perhaps this left-hander encapsulates everything that is so challenging about Toronto, because on approach, you have two different kinds of asphalt. You have concrete. To driver's left, you have pronounced curving. To driver's right, you have a Cooper Tires barrier. So the fortunate thing is, by this point of the weekend, it's rubbered up, so grip is at a premium here, but still very, very tough to tackle this left-hander. Then it's a short jaunt into turn number 6, and this is perhaps the most challenging portion of this course. At least several drivers have said that, because it's a sweeping, pronounced turn that seems to last forever. You want to carry as much speed, the minimum speed, through there if possible, because you're going to tackle the most technical, tricky portion of the race course, Nick Yeoman, when you clear turn number 7. That's 8 through 11, and we have seen it be a challenge throughout the course of this weekend. Again, a beautiful day for racing here in one of North America's great cities, Toronto.
Yep, a lot of drivers getting sideways out of turn number 8, and a lot of drivers swinging wide and tagging the concrete walls in turn 11. We'll see if these 9 drivers can keep those cars off the wall like they have done for the majority of this weekend. Well, of course, if you're new to the Indy Lights Series, there are no live pit stops, but that doesn't mean we don't have a couple talented pit reporters out there to talk about the action that we're going to see on track, as well as some of the storylines to follow. We start with Rob Blackman. Rob, very interested to see how this race shakes out and how different it might be from yesterday's race.
It will be interesting to see. I will say this, Nick Yeoman, you know, one thing that's very typical, a third wheel always seems to show up and ruin a great partnership when you're, say, on a long weekend in, say, a city like Toronto. That's going to happen this weekend, don't you think? Oliver Askew and Rinus VK have been running 1 and 2 all series long throughout this Indy Lights summer, and Askew currently a slight lead over VK as they come into this weekend. But it's been the part-timer Aaron Tielitz that has really stolen the thunder, at least through the first couple of days here in Toronto. Tielitz taking the checkered flag yesterday, he will start P3 here today. Let's see if he can ruin it again today for Askew and VK before this afternoon is done.
He's got a fast car, there's no doubt about it. The only problem, Rob Howden, is Aaron Tielitz is looking forward and sees those two championship competitors. Going to be an awful interesting 40-lap race here in Toronto.
Yeah, a little bit of a contrast from yesterday indeed, was it not? As Aaron Tielitz, of course, had a new track record here as well. Very, very quick. Ballardi Auto Racing has always been good here. A lot of great winners like Felix Rosenquist in the years past who have been able to score victories here for them. But again, interesting to see those young drivers, Oliver Askew and Rinus VK, kind of come back unfazed by the fact that the veteran came back in to win yesterday. I like the fact that both these guys are in a championship chase, but you know, Nick, you and I talked about it before. No worries about the championship for Aaron Tielitz. He can push as hard as he wants because Brian Ballardi wants to sweep this weekend once again.
Yep, simply wants to go out there and win races and impress car owners. That's the game plan for Aaron Tielitz. As he is looking for the weekend sweep, he will do so from the third starting position with 1 and 2 in the points, starting right alongside or right ahead of him in row number 1. Field making their way out of turn number 8. They'll start to pack up the final couple of corners that run parallel to the pit lane. It's anything but parallel, though, because it's a swooping left-hander, right-hander, and then back to the left for turn 11. It's Oliver Askew, your pole sitter. He's going to start to driver's right. Rinus VK to driver's left. VK already trying to nose ahead. It's a super, super slow start out of turn 11, and it's going to be an immediate yellow flag. Kyle Kaiser, I was waiting for someone to run into somebody because that's about as slow as I think I have ever seen them crawl to start-finish line.
Yeah, that is a really tricky battle that you have when you're trying to pack up in those really tight quarters from 8 through 11. And you could tell that Rinus was trying to not go offline, and he was forcing Oliver pretty wide. So, I mean, I think that was a good call to go yellow for that. start.
It also looked like Dalton Kellett, I mean, had to check up there because he was ready to accelerate out of turn number 11. Last thing he wanted to do was run into a teammate.
Yeah, exactly. You got to be very careful about that. And as we saw yesterday, you know, the pole sitter got a huge jump. So I think Greenis is very careful about not letting that happen again.
7 times in 10 races this year, the pole sitter in Indy Lights has gone on to win the event. That doesn't mean that they've stayed up front the entire race. We've seen lots of challenges throughout the course of this season. But, boy, qualifying is so key. And I think Oliver Askew knew it. He wants to get a great jump out of turn number 11 to make sure he can grab that top spot. So we will retry the start of this race here from Toronto. The starting lineup again, Askew and VK in row number 1, Tielitz and Kellett in row number 2, Sowry and McGinnis in row 3, David Malukas and Ryan Norman in row number 4, and then Lucas Cole, the other Ballardi Auto Racing driver, starts shotgun on the field in the 9th position. Field making their way through turn number 8. Oliver Askew has them all lined up single file. As soon as they clear turn 8 and approach the pit wall, that's when they start to pack up. Renus VK jumps to his outside through turn number 9, and the rest of the field will now get in line as well. The 9 drivers of the Indy Lights Series. This, of course, the future stars of the NTT IndyCar Series here for the Cooper Tires Grand Prix of Toronto, presented by Allied Building Products. The pace looks a little bit better out of turn 11, and we will see the twin green flags. We are racing here in Toronto. Askew's got the early advantage. They're going to go 3 wide, though, into turn number 1. Aaron Tielitz jumps up the inside, and he'll pass both Askew and VK to grab the top spot. So Renus VK jumps into 2nd, but it's Aaron Tielitz, the winner from yesterday, who grabs the lead in turn 1.
And why not? Aaron Tielitz led all 35 laps yesterday. Looks like he might lead lap number 1. Renus VK to the inside. Not going to be there, though. It's Tielitz leading this single file line. Heading your way, Mark James.
Guess he heard the pre-race comments of what Rob Blackman saying. He was going to be the interloper in this battle for the championship between VK and Askew. He has about a 4-car length advantage now as they make their way through turn number 6.
Kyle, how about that jump and that move from Aaron Tielitz right at the start?
That was a great move. Just getting to the inside was the smartest place to be. Obviously, I think Oliver was defending against Renus going wide, so that opened it up right for Aaron there.
Boy, it was just a fantastic move. He jumped to the inside. They went 3 wide into turn number 1. Plenty of racetrack to use in turn 1, but the driver on the inside almost always has the advantage, and Aaron Tielitz is flat on it. After lap number 1, not only does he grab the lead, but he grabs a 1.2-second advantage. Further back, David Malukas, he'll take look to the inside of Robert McGinnis. That's a battle for the 6th position. McGinnis slams the door closed as they'll race out of turn number 2. It's Aaron Tielitz, your leader.
Why not? You would think this is a carbon copy start from yesterday. Aaron Tielitz with a 4-car length advantage. This time, though, it's Renus VK is 2nd. Oliver Askew now back to 3rd, followed by Dalton Kellett, Toby Sowry, the top 5.
Got to keep an eye on Robert McGinnis today. He's trying to stay in the battle for the championship, and he did no better than a 6th-place finish yesterday. He's trying to improve upon that today and hopes to stay back into that championship run.
Day 1st, looks like we've got issues down in Turn 3.
Well, we did have issues in Turn 3. Ryan Norman overcooked it, missed the corner in Turn 3. That 110-degree right-hander just went right past it, didn't go all the way into the runoff area, but still had to wall up the car, stopped it, engine was killed, had to restart it, but that number 48 machine for Andretti Autosport now back underway.
And he was getting a ferocious challenge from Lucas Cole. That was at the rear of the field. Cole getting alongside in a couple different corners, and Norman just simply couldn't get that car wove down to the outside. It is Aaron Tielitz, your leader. He's got about an 8-car length advantage over Renus VK. That translates to about 1.2 seconds. VK has to keep pace, day 1st. 1.5 seconds, that magical number to use the push to pass.
And he's not even close to that right now. Making about a 6-car length advantage as Renus tries to reel in Aaron Tielitz. Still single file and no change. Toby Sowry still sitting there. David Malukas, Robert McGinnis. McGinnis trying to make up some ground.
Yeah, Sowry is right there on the 67 machine of Dalton Kellett. He has about a 3-car length advantage, Kellett does, but Sowry gets a really good run to the entrance to turn 6.
Kyle, we just had a chance to see some replays of the start. We're also seeing how good that battle between Norman and Cole was. Turn 1, as I said, it's wide, but boy, it seems like it really funnels down once you hit the apex and get into turn two.
Yeah, that's a great way to describe it. And I was holding my breath seeing Rinus try to go three wide to the outside, but it was great heads up driving from Oliver's standpoint to not just track out all the way, because that could have been a big accident.
Yep, so VK has settled into the second position. Then it's Oliver Askew. Best battle on the racetrack right now appears to be for the fourth position. Dalton Kellett hauls off into turn number one. It's a right-hander, and he's got Toby Sowry all over that rear wing. As Kellett racing in front of his home Canadian fans, he's got a lot of company because Toby Sowry's got a nice run out of turn number two. Dave, first, Sowry pops to the outside looking for four.
He'll pop to the outside, and he'll take over that fourth position. Very clean pass over the Canadian, but now Sowry goes wide into turn four. Side by side, Mark Jane's heading your way.
And they're going to go to turn five side by side, but Sowry has the preferred line to the bottom. We'll see if Kellett can cross him over and get to the outside. He cannot because Sowry shuts the door. Pretty good battle for fourth now as it rages on through turn number six.
Sowry gets a nice run through turn seven and eight, and he'll put about a car length or two between him and Dalton Kellett. Kellett is sawing on that steering wheel. That car got awful loose for the setup of turn number eight, and he's not done because now David Malukas, the young driver for BN Racing, is all over the rear wing as they snake through the S's around pit lane. Malukas trying to grab that fifth position now from Dalton Kellett. A replay of that pass down into turn three. That's a tough spot, Kyle, to get the cars woed down.
Yeah, it looks like he definitely used that push to pass to get a really good run, and it was hard to get that car slowed down. He ended up running wide, but maintaining that inside line was crucial for him to keep that line there.
So now day first, Dalton Kellett has to kind of regather his stuff as he slipped to the fifth position as he's going to try to hold off David Malukas, who is giving a challenge.
Yep. First offense, now he's playing defense. Sowry leads this trio. Kellett has about a car length advantage over David Malukas. Don't forget about Robert McGinnis. He's about three car lengths back.
All trying to catch Oliver Askew, and they can't do it. That threesome have separated themselves from Robert McGinnis. For now, all he can do off turn number five is watch them pull away through turn six.
A nice thing for Robert McGinnis sitting in the seventh position. Kyle, these guys start battling. He's going to creep right into this and make it a four-horse battle.
Yeah, we can see him starting to reel him in now. They're starting to use their push to pass and slowing each other down, making passes on each other. It's going to make a four-person race for sure.
Saw Dalton Kellett getting passed by Toby Sowry, falling into the fifth position. Then all of a sudden, he got a great run out of turn two, gapped himself a little bit from David Malukas, and I thought he might even challenge Toby Sowry. This time across the line, Sowry's advantage over Dalton Kellett is 1.2 seconds, and there's David Malukas, just 0.4 off the rear wing of Dalton Kellett. Kellett's car stepped sideways. He got a little loose exiting turn two. This might be the opportunity Malukas needs. Dave, first, it's a great battle for fifth as Dalton Kellett tries to hang on.
Stay in line. Now pop to the outside. It may not help him in turn three, but certainly would in turns four and five. Then he snaps back into line. Yep, Dalton Kellett continues to lead.
Sowry now has designs on catching Oliver Askew. Meanwhile, the 67 of Dalton Kellett sees Malukas all over his rearview mirrors. It's a half a car length now as they set up for turn seven.
Yeah, there's no doubt Kellett is hanging on to that race car. We can see from some of the shots way the hand movement inside the cockpit. You never want to see the jarring movements like Dalton Kellett. He's certainly hanging on.
It looks like a handful, and I'm watching him in the brake zones. It looks like he might be running a little too much rear bias, because every time he's getting to that brake pedal, I'm seeing the rear step out quite a bit, and that's just going to kill the rears early in this race.
And how hard is that? It's hard enough, I would imagine, on lap six. What's that like on lap 40 towards the end of the race?
Yeah, it's not getting any better, I can promise you that. So he's going to have to be on top of his tools, maybe start adjusting that bias, do whatever he can to keep these tires underneath him.
Aaron Tielitz is still your leader by 1.2 seconds over Rinus VK. So VK is hanging tough in that second spot. Then it is Oliver Askew. Toby Sowry runs in fourth, and Dave first again. That battle for fifth is really tight heading to turn three.
It is, but right now it is unchanged. Malukas right behind Dalton Kellett. Call it a half car length or so. Canadian, head your way, Mark.
Front three continue to pull away. Toby Sowry continues to pull away. And yeah, that battle continues to be a good one. That's David Malukas, 79. Trying to chase down the 67 of Dalton Kellett. Kellett has not wavered in the past couple of laps.
Yeah, he's had an awful nice job of keeping David Malukas at bay and around a street course. Kyle, that cannot be easy when you've got someone pressured.
It is not, and we could see, I'm looking here, Malukas only has four push to passes left, and it's lap eight. So I really think that you know, this will probably start to spread out as he starts to maybe conserve those last four push to passes so he has some at the end of the race.
As a driver, are you thinking about that? Are you wanting that type of information from your engineer in terms of someone who's attacking them, knowing, hey, I may only have to hold on for three or four more laps because he may use up the push to pass?
Yeah, and if he, it's kind of a balance here. It does spread out usually towards the middle of these races because tires start to fall off. It gets hard to run close. So David really wants to make a move now so he can get that position and hope that the tire degradation will allow them to spread out. But at the same time, at the end of this race, when guys are starting to catch back up, you might be struggling with your car and you have no way of defending, it's going to hurt you.
I'm always fascinated when you get a late race caution and then all of a sudden you bunch the field up and then there's somebody who's still got, you know, 16 opportunities to use that push to pass. It gives you extra horsepower if you're within 1.5 seconds of someone. And I'll tell you what, someone who's keeping good pace is second place running Rinus VK, just a couple car lengths off of Aaron Tielitz. Yesterday, Kyle, Tielitz flat left the field at the start of the race, won by 4 or 5 seconds. Like, Rinus VK clearly knows I can't let that happen today.
Yeah, it looked like he might have been struggling with some tire temps early in the race, but right now his car is hooked up and he's not using his push to pass to close this gap, so that's going to be very important for the end of this race.
Says a lot about how good that Juncos Racing car is. Dave, first, let's take a peek at that battle for the lead. Aaron Tielitz has it, but Rinus VK about four car lengths as they exit two.
VK thinking about today, also thinking about perhaps the next couple of weeks. That points championship battle is heating up, trying to stay ahead of Oliver Askew, a half car length back of Aaron Tielitz.
Yeah, the last couple of laps it has closed dramatically. It was about three car lengths now, and Aaron Tielitz knows he's there and he has to hit his marks for sure. The 21 of Rinus VK in hot pursuit off of turn number seven.
And it's just fascinating. Aaron Tielitz not in this championship hunt, but you've raced against Aaron Tielitz. Very talented driver and good equipment like Ballardi's got. We know what he's capable, and he showed it this weekend.
Yeah, it was so impressive for him to jump back in, having not been in the car, driven on this track in so long. Really, really impressive work by him.
But for the first time all weekend, he has a challenger, and it is Rinus VK, who is second in points, just six markers behind Oliver Askew. He is within a couple car lengths into turn one. We have a battle for the lead here in the Indy Light Series presented by Cooper Tires. Tielitz by a couple car lengths exiting turn two. Looks like he got a nice run in that cherry red car for Ballardi Auto Racing. But here comes VK. Davey looks to the outside.
VK to the outside. Has a room. All the back end comes around. He's going to try to make it to the outside of turn number three. Aaron Tielitz goes a little wide, protects that position. He maintains the advantage.
He gathers it back in, but look what this has done. This has now turned it into a three-car battle as Oliver Askew is all over that duo. So it's a three-car race now as we exit turn number six.
A very near miss down in turn three. That was almost an absolute disaster, but it has opened up a three-car race now for the lead. Tielitz, VK, and Askew all over each other through the S's of turns 9, 10, and 11. Heading back for the start-finish line. Aaron Tielitz, your race leader here on lap number 10. Askew runs in the third position. He's about five or six car lengths off of Rinus VK. Is those front two going to have to kind of just regather things here as we start lap number 11? They'll barrel into the right-hander of turn number one. VK giving chase to Aaron Tielitz out of turn two. Not sure if he has nearly as good of a run, but Dave, first, those three cars all separated by about three or four car lengths down the long backstretch.
Single file this time and no advantage, although VK this time takes a bit of a look to the outside. Single file, it's Tielitz, VK, Oliver Askew, all within a couple car lengths.
Yeah, maybe Rinus VK has filed something to the memory bank, and when he gets a little closer, maybe he'll take a little different approach to turn number three in hopes of making that pass on Aaron Tielitz. For now, that threesome set sail for turn number seven.
Kyle, that near miss down in turn three took my breath away. That was almost, it reminded me of the trip that RC Enerson took, very similar, where we very nearly saw the right front of Rinus VK catch that left rear of Aaron Tielitz.
Yeah, I know exactly what he was trying to do. Tielitz was pretty far down, and he was anticipating him to kind of close that gap up to him, and Tielitz just kind of maintained. That was kind of the right move on his part, but Rinus was expecting him to come up, and he'd hoped to do the crossover before so he could get to the inside. But since Tielitz didn't move, that was really close to an accident.
Yeah, I mean, it was from the vantage point that we had looking down the straightaway with the cars coming at us, it looked like a matter of inches or maybe just feet in between Aaron Tielitz and Rinus VK. But Dave, that battle continues to be a good one. Three car battle for the lead.
it allows us to all kind of catch our breaths after what happened a couple of weeks ago. Askew now with a nice run on VK, but it remains Tielitz, VK Askew.
Yeah, and Tielitz has started to step out just a little bit. At least he got an awfully good run through three and four. He's opened up a couple of car length advantage. A guy hoping that the three of them get together and allow him to catch that pack is fourth place running Toby Sowery, but he's got some work to do in order to make it a four-car battle.
Day first, one of the other championship contenders, Ryan Norman, rough start to this race. Looked like he might have just picked up a spot there at the rear of the field.
He did, and to the outside. Remember, Ryan Norman moved his way up to third place in the Indy Lights Series Points Championship. Just picked up a spot. Ryan Norman now eighth, Lucas Cole in ninth.
So Ryan Norman will continue to try to charge back towards the front of the field. Aaron Tielitz just laid down the fastest lap of this race at a minute 5.156, and he needs every tenth of a second that he can find out of this racetrack, because Rinus VK simply not going away here on lap number 13. Askew is kind of held at bay down in turn number three as they race towards that right-hander. But there's Aaron Tielitz and Rinus VK giving chase, Mark James, as they head to turn five.
Yeah, front two started to check out a little bit. Oliver Askew doing all he can to keep that a three-car battle. But now suddenly we get the impression by looking at it to the naked eye, if you will, it's turned back into a two-horse race now as they set up for turn seven.
And as close as that near miss was, as much as Oliver Askew wants to get up, Kyle, and mix it up for this race win, at the same time, with how those two are racing each other, that can be a pretty nervous position for the driver in car 28.
I think Oliver's playing this really smart. I think sitting back, letting it play out. We're only on lap 14 of 40 right now, so this is a long race. He has only five push to passes left, and Rinus is using his up, so I think this is the smart move on his end.
Yep, that's the voice of Kyle Kaiser, IndyCar Series driver, a former Indy Lights champion, joining us here on the Advanced Auto Parts IndyCar Radio Network. This is the Indy Lights Series presented by Cooper Tires. Aaron Tielitz is your leader. He just got a really nice run out of turn number two. Looks like he'll keep Rinus VK at bay into turn number three. Dave, though, let's take a look at that battle for fifth once again, though. You mentioned Dalton Kellett, David Malukas continue to absolutely slug it out.
We forgot about this battle for fifth as Dalton Kellett did a nice job of holding off David Malukas, but now the difference is about a car length and a half. Colton over Malukas.
Yeah, we're going to watch that battle. It's a good one. It's about a car length and a half now as Kellett gets here first. Malukas in tow. Malukas staying right in the tire tracks and keeping the deficit at about a car length.
Yeah, he's made Dalton Kellett sweat over the last seven or eight laps. There's no doubt about it, but the old adage, Kyle, is catching a guy is one thing, pass him is another, and Malukas has found that to be pretty tough to get around Dalton Kellett.
Yeah, and it looks like Malukas has used all his push to pass up, so it's definitely going to be really challenging. Dalton's going to have to make a pretty big mistake if Malukas is going to get around.
After a mid-race challenge by Rinus VK, Aaron Tielitz has done a pretty nice job. He's pushed that lead back out to 1.1 seconds. That translates to about seven or eight car lengths. Down the back straightaway they go. VK runs in the second position, and then another seven or eight car links back is Oliver Askew. That's how they run one through three. Toby Sowery pretty comfortable in his own area code right now in the fourth position. He is 5.5 seconds behind the race leader of Aaron Tielitz, but another 6.5 seconds over fifth place running Dalton Kellett. As we've detailed, Dalton Kellett's had his hands full with David Malukas all race long. That's the battle for fifth as Malukas sits in the sixth spot. Then it's Robert McGinnis in seventh. Ryan Norman moments ago picked up the eighth position away from Lucas Cole, who runs last in the field. Here at Toronto, it's his lap number 15 of 40 scheduled here for the Indy Lights Series, the Cooper Tires Grand Prix of Toronto presented by Allied Building Products. And Rob Howden, this of course the top step on the road to Indy. These drivers all looking for an opportunity to race in the NTT IndyCar Series one day, but it has been a busy road to Indy weekend, and you've had the coverage of all those races this weekend.
Yeah, lots of racing for sure, and you get a chance to talk right now to a driver who got his first win in the Cooper Tires USF 2000 Championship, Christian Rasmussen. Good season so far. You've had some ups and downs, but wow, kind of a turning point weekend for you. On the podium yesterday, your first win today. Has it sunk in yet?
It's fantastic. I mean, I had goosebumps driving around the track on the last lap, just knowing that this was probably going to be a win. It was amazing, and we have been fighting hard for this first win in this, like, turn around the championship. So hopefully we can build on that momentum and get some good race finishes for the rest of the season.
Christian drives for Jay Howard Driver Development. You're also from Denmark, one of our international drivers in this field. How does this change your focus moving forward? Do you feel like maybe the team's kind of coming together, a big weekend here in Toronto? You can start looking forward to Mid-Ohio?
Yeah, obviously we are a new team in this series. I haven't driven any of the tracks before. The team hasn't been on the tracks before, so obviously it was going to be hard at first, but I think we've got it now, and hopefully we can challenge the guys for the rest of the season.
All right, one last question before we let you go. You had a couple of restarts. We had some yellow flags. Always tough on you as a driver on a restart, right? Trying to just time that jump early. You were on it at turn number 8, I think. You were able to get away. Those restarts make you nervous at all?
I think the restarts went well for me. I mean, it was only the last restart that I was a bit nervous about that one, because I know that I would only have one lap. But yeah, I mean, it went well. I think I did some good restart. I managed to pull a gap. I think I was leading by 3 seconds by the restarts, and I mean, yeah, it was good.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Big smile, guys. The first ever win here on the Road to Indy. Christian Rasmussen from Denmark for Jay Howard Driver Development. A solid weekend here, a podium yesterday, and a win today. And Nick Yeoman, another name to watch here on the Road to Indy.
Yep, congratulations to Christian and that team on that first win. That's certainly big for him. And Kyle, everyone experiences that first win at some point. You have, and certainly that's got to be a good feeling for that young man. And I would think that this racetrack instantly becomes a special place when you get to visit it in the future.
For sure. This is a great racetrack, and getting that first win off your back, it's a great feeling, and it gives you so much confidence going to the next race weekend. So hopefully they can cascade that into some more wins.
Well, one of the best battles on the racetrack for the majority of this race was the battle for fifth, as Dalton Kellett was trying to hold off David Malukas. Moments ago, Malukas had issues, though, down in turn 8. Looks like he shot a little wide, went into the runoff area, and then took him a while to get that car kind of refired and spun back around. Lost an absolute a ton of track position. Malukas falls all the way to 9th, last in the running order, and that allows Dalton Kellett finally, I would imagine, Kyle, to breathe a little bit easier, knowing that he doesn't have that 79 car all over the rear wing.
Yeah, he does have a little bit of breathing room now, but not as much as he'd probably like. McGinnis is only about 1.6 seconds back, and as we know, that 1.5 second barrier, I'm sure McGinnis is going to be pushing so he can start using that push to pass. He's been saving it up. He has 12 left. So if he can get within that range, I wouldn't be surprised if he caught back up.
Yep, we'll keep an eye on that deficit. Continues to be right around that 1.5 range, the gap between our race leader, Aaron Tielitz, back to Rinus VK, and just 1.2 seconds back to VK and Askew. But clearly, those drivers have been able to stay at that pace for the majority of the race, this race being a little bit longer than yesterday's event. Do you sense they're not trying to use up the push to pass too much? Although VK and Askew have been hammering that button plenty here in this race.
Yeah, those two have definitely been using it. They want to maintain that 1.5 gap between the cars, and they're getting that information from the team and from their engineers constantly. If they're falling too far behind, they'll say, hey, we need this time to catch back up and get within the time gap. So they might be pushing that push to pass just to maintain that gap.
Aaron Tielitz, your race leader, trying to sweep the weekend here in the Indy Lights Series presented by Cooper Tires and score the win in race number 2 of the Cooper Tires Grand Prix of Toronto presented by Allied Building Products. Of course, all these drivers running on those Cooper Tires. Cool to see them step up as the title sponsor of this event. Kyle, you spent many years driving on those Cooper Tires. The folks, Chris Pantani, that entire group, they seemingly do a great job, especially considering it's 3 different race cars from the USF 2000, Indy Pro 2000, all the way up to Indy Lights.
Yeah, they do an incredible job, and the support that they bring to all the teams, they're very open and transparent with the information they give to the team. So it was always a pleasure racing with them in all the series.
Kyle Kaiser is our driver analyst here for the Indy Lights race here at Toronto. And, of course, folks have been watching you here for Juncos Racing in the IndyCar Series, a thrilling month of May, putting that car in the show for the Indianapolis 500. What was that experience like for you, and how, I imagine, the itch to get back in the race car has got to be pretty strong right now?
Yeah, I'm always itching to get back behind the wheel of any race car. So I was fortunate to have the opportunity to do the 500, like you said, and do some other races with Juncos this year. So, I'm hoping we can get some more races in at the end of the year. You know, we're working really hard on that. So that's the plan right now.
All of a sudden, that battle for the lead starting to heat up again. It was about 1.4 short seconds. And as you talked about, Kyle just got to try to keep it at 1.5. Here comes Arenas VK, Dave first. He closed it to within a half a second as they race out of turn two, though. Aaron Tielitz with a strong run.
Tielitz with a nice run off the exit of turn number two. And Arenas VK kind of weaving back and forth, making sure that Aaron Tielitz knows he's right there. Tielitz looks at his rearview mirrors. That's all he sees. Here he comes, VK.
Yeah, a really good run for Arenas VK up the hill, and that little switchback, if you will, to the setup for turn number four. He is full throttle now, literally right up underneath the rear wing of Aaron Tielitz.
Kyle, it's a dangerous game, but it definitely seems like it's still a game down into turn three. Jockeying for position, sliding over. We've seen a lot of those drivers moving left to right, right to left on the approach to that third corner.
Part of that might be strategy, but I can tell you from driving that corner, it's just bumpy.
Really?
It's bumpy down there. And when you're in the draft and you're trying to stay behind the car in front of you and you hit a bump with a little bit of wheel, your car is going to bounce around and move around. So I don't think there's too much intention with that. But I've been looking at the times, and Arenas, the last two laps, pulled off some mega flyers without using his push to pass. He was in the mid-104s, which really closed that gap up to Aaron.
Yep, that type of consistency has been strong, and Dave first, that's why he continues to challenge Aaron Tielitz for the lead.
That gap a bit distance than it is the last one. Make it car length and a half. Tielitz with a nice run off of turn two, clearly off turn three and turn four.
Yeah, it's really fun being at this vantage point. If you look right down into the cockpit, and you can see when they bump the curbing to the left side of the car, really disruptive to the steering wheel. I mean, they're gripping it awfully tight through here. And as we mentioned in our opening comments, Nick, and you can get Kyle to speak to this, the thing I think most challenging about this corner, there's two different kinds of asphalt. There's concrete, there's curbing, and there's a lot of patching down here. That presents a big challenge in terms of grip.
Especially, Kyle, when those Cooper tires, that rubber starts to go away, I imagine.
Yeah, it does not get easier throughout the race, and you have to get creative. I think you'll see a lot of these drivers using that curbing, even though it's aggressive and it's probably not the best for the car, they're using that curbing because there's no other way to make the car turn other than just plow the car into a piece of curbing to get the rear to jump loose. So it's very aggressive. It's intense driving on this racetrack, and you need to ask every single bit of yourself to get every tenth out of the car.
How about that left-hander where Mark's at up in turn number five? I mean, you're able to wiggle your way through turn three, which, as we talked about, it's hard enough getting those cars wove down with the bumpy surface. Then you're crawling back uphill through turn four as we see our leader Aaron Tielitz head that way. And then turn five, that concrete wall, it sneaks up and it's grabbed a lot of drivers throughout the course of the
year. Yeah, that is one of the most challenging corners on this racetrack. And like I was saying, as you're turning in, you have pretty good grip, but then you get onto that concrete patch where you lose all the grip. So you have to anticipate that and use all that curbing. That's why you're seeing the cars getting up there, getting a little bit sideways.
Boy, Aaron Tielitz just had a major moment down in turn eight. He misjudged the entry, had to woe it up to avoid the tire barriers, and now Arenas VK is all over that rear wing out of turn number 11. They're separated by just a few feet. Tielitz, again, has to gather it back up. VK looks to the outside as they approach turn number one. The right-hander, he's got that front wing. VK does up underneath the rear wing of Aaron Tielitz, and this might be the opportunity he needs. Out of turn number two, VK giving chase. Dave first, he's got a run. We may have a side-by-side battle for the lead.
Could he be the Flying Dutchman here in Toronto, working his way around Aaron Tielitz, side-by-side, over the two-man contact, and Arenas VK both and Aaron Tielitz hard into the tire barrier at the exit of turn number two. Many cars go by. Toby Sowery gets around. Tielitz is able to refire. He's cleanly away now from turn number three through turn four. Arenas VK has refired. Dalton Kellett gets around him. Oh boy, the front two falling back here in Toronto.
Kyle Kaiser, the battle for the lead into turn number three spills over. Both drivers see a win wash away.
Yeah, that's definitely not what you want to see happen here. Obviously, pretty heavy damage to Arenas' front wing, so he's going to have to probably come into the pits here. That's a terrible scenario for both Tielitz and Arenas.
And all of a sudden now, our points leader, Oliver Askew, is the race leader. We see VK lose another position, and Rob Howden, he is going to make his way to pit lane.
Aaron Tielitz, the first driver coming into pit lane, he's coming as well. Front nose damage, they'll pull a new front wing out for him. Same thing here as well for Arenas. VK is coming in hot here right now. The number 21 machine, an uncharacteristic error for Arenas. VK has actually shut the motor off here, guys. This is not something we've seen from this driver in 3 years of contact, or 3 years of racing rather. Tielitz getting that new nose and he's underway. They're having a look at this race car right now. I think I'm just having a look to see if there's any other issues on the car. They've got the new wing on the machine, Nick, but as I said, they have the They have the actual engine shut off on it right now. It looks like they may have to change the right rear tire. They're going to bring the tire back around. So Rinus VK, guys, I think he's going to go down a lap here, our championship challenger, an uncharacteristic mistake in turn number three.
What a disaster for Rinus VK, looking for a race win, looking for the lead, and it all spills over. Kyle, you've had a chance to watch the replay. What do you think exactly happened down there in three?
Yeah, I think a little bit of blame can be assigned to both drivers, to be honest. It looked like both drivers locked up a little bit, obviously carrying as much speed into the corner. Aaron locked up a tiny bit and came a little wide, but I think Rinus turned in a little bit on him as well. So I think it's just a little bit of fault at both drivers and just obviously an unfortunate scenario, but this plays right in Oliver Askew's hands. He was sitting back there, saving his push to pass, and obviously an error on the front two drivers, and now it's his race now.
Rob Houghton's got more on the repairs to Rinus VK's machine.
Yeah, guys, not just the front wing, nor just that right rear as well. The left front wishbone, the trailing end of the wishbone bent as well. So the contact made by overbraking to turn number three, and of course, the trip into the tires, more damage than we thought of the number 21 jumbo machine for Rinus VK. He still sits within the seat, but the crew working feverishly to try to get a new wishbone on this thing. Trouble, as we said, for Rinus VK. We have not seen this in the 3 years of competition he's had. This has been a calling card for Rinus VK. He just doesn't make these kind of mistakes. The pressure, though, trying to go for the lead around Aaron Tielitz, a little too much for the driver from the Netherlands.
Yeah, and I hate to rub it in, but he had a six-point deficit to Oliver Askew heading into this race, and with that pass, he would have taken over the points lead provisionally. Now, with him falling, Rinus VK all the way to the tail end of the feed, and Oliver Askew picking up the pieces to grab the top spot, his lead over Toby Sauer. Is 5.8 seconds as they run right now. Oliver Askew's lead over Rinus VK balloons to 25 points. So these are the type of moments, Kyle, ultimately that can decide championships.
Yeah, that was definitely a very deciding factor right there. It's not to say that he's out of it. There's still plenty of races to go for sure. But it's tough, especially in a field of nine cars, to gain that point advantage, because you'll need a tragic day for Oliver now if he's planning on making up those points.
Yep, and Askew hasn't had many of those this season. A 10th place finish at St. Petersburg, but he's been pretty strong in the top five all season long. Let's go to pit lane and Rob Blackman.
Well, certainly those with Juncos Racing are not very pleased right now, and I think it's safe to say the same for Bilardi Auto Racing with the team of Aaron Tielitz. But I can tell you this, standing in front of the Oliver Askew pit box, when that accident happened here on the big screen in front of the pit boxes, fists were thrust into the air with the Andretti Autosport team, because they know they literally are in the driver's seat.
And we kind of teased that up, didn't we? I mean, we talked about those two, Tielitz and VK, really running strong, and there was Oliver Askew all of a sudden to pick up the pieces. Very lucky, because turn three is a part where we've seen full-fledged parking lots over the years when that racetrack can get blocked up.
Yeah, he played it very smart, and I could tell he was just saving his push to pass for the end, which is the smart way to play this race. And it played into his hands, but a lot of credit has to go to him the way he was racing it.
Hey, Dave, first, how about that battle for fifth between Norman and McGinnis?
Norman and McGinnis side by side now through turn three. Norman's got to wash a little to the outside, and he'll give up that position.
Little by little, he's been closing in on Robert McGinnis, and he ducks to the inside of the setup at turn number five, but McGinnis shuts the door. They are nose to tail as they sweep their way around turn number six.
Yeah, I've been kind of keeping a side eye on that battle as everything shook out up front, because Ryan Norman, after a mistake early in the race, he continues to try to gun his way back towards the front, certainly helped by the fact that Tielitz and VK had their issues. This, again, the battle for the fourth position. Oliver Askew runs in the top spot. Toby Sauer is second. Dalton Kellett is third. And this is now the battle for fourth as Robert McGinnis and Ryan Norman, a pair of Andretti Autosport teammates, roar into turn at number one. McGinnis has got that spot by about a car length and a half. They both look awful smooth through turn number two. This is the opportunity where Ryan Norman can jump on that push to pass and use that little extra horsepower. Looks like he's got a nice run, Dave. They might be side by side by the time they get to you.
They are side by side under the overhang there in the Ontario Place, as McGinnis has the, well, he's going to give up that position to Ryan Norman, who goes sweeping around the outside of turn three, then to the inside of turn four.
Norman fourth yesterday. McGinnis could do no better than sixth, and both trying to stay in that championship hunt. So every position worth valuable points now as they set up for turn seven.
Ryan Norman put a lot of faith in his teammate there heading out of turn three, because he had that car planted right in the middle of the racetrack. McGinnis certainly wasn't going to have a very good arc or angle into that corner, was he?
I think that's a great comparison of what it's like to drive against a teammate and drive against somebody that's not on your team. He turned in with full faith, and it was great driving by McGinnis to not push his luck there.
All right, so again, it's Oliver Askew, your race leader. We've got 10 laps to go here in Toronto. Toby Sowery runs in second. Dalton Killen is third. Rob Blackman, I know you've been keeping an eye on the repairs for Rinus VK. Is he able to get that car back onto the racetrack?
Indeed he was, Nick. Just about 60 seconds or so ago, Rob Howden did a great job of keeping you updated on all of the changes, the multiple changes that had to be made to that machine for Rinus VK. But those changes have been made, and he is back racing once again.
Yep, and the frustrating part is he is four laps down now in the ninth position, and as the sand runs out of the hourglass, it's going to be awful tough to even fight his way out of that ninth place position. Well, we really appreciate this young man for being patient down on pit lane, because things got awful wild there in the midway point of this race. But Rob Howden, he also kind of understands it, because he was in the booth yesterday. I like to call it IndyCar radio karma. You sit in the booth, and lo and behold, you take home a first place trophy. Congratulate Kyle Kirkwood from all of us.
Yeah, Nick, I mentioned that to Kyle already, and the guys in the booth want to congratulate you on your run today, Kyle Kirkwood, because we talk about IndyCar radio karma. You're in the booth, you end up winning. Now, here's the one thing. A lot of action, of course, on the front of this one. You're watching it happen. You were kind of watching that dice kind of develop. You figured the Rinus was going to make a move pretty soon. No issues for you, though. Qualified on pole both races. Trouble yesterday, but today, one of those textbook race wins.
Yeah, like you said, we had an issue yesterday. Ended up hitting the wall and getting an eighth place finish after starting first. Today, we were able to start first again, but this time, I knew exactly what I did wrong yesterday on the start. Made sure I defended more and was able to get a gap early on, because Parker and Rasmus Lind battled it out going down into turn three. So created a gap and kind of just held that probably about a 1 second gap, and it's really tough to race around the track. But for myself, I knew I had to stay perfect, because Parker is one of those drivers where you don't expect him to make a mistake. And if he's not going to make a mistake, then I can't make a mistake, because one mistake around this track, then you're off in dirty, dirty track, extremely dirty. And as you just saw with Rinus and Aaron, as soon as you get down to the inside, Aaron was on the dirty track, locked up, and especially in turn three, it's notorious for that, where you just go straight. And a lot of us, we'll almost do it by ourselves, which is very uncharacteristic of a lot of us.
You know, we've had five different winners in the last five races in USF 2000. Not the same in Indy Pro. You won three of the last four races. Can you talk about the momentum you and your team have? Obviously, coming together with RP Motorsport, they believe in you, you believe in them. That's one of those, you know, equations that starts to lead to a lot of success.
It definitely does. We struggled at the beginning of the season with a few issues, and now we've got a really good rhythm. But I think this track here was probably going to be our toughest, and I think actually it's our strongest. So I think when we go to Mid-Ohio, it's going to be really good, because last year, if anybody remembers what happened to RP, they had some really, really bad races. And this year we had a couple really, really good races and two poles in the qualifying. So it was it's a fantastic day, fantastic weekend, and we've got a lot of momentum heading into Mid-Ohio now.
Definitely closed up along the points. Good luck when we get to Mid-Ohio. 2 weeks, you're back in the car.
Thank you so much, Rob. Yep.
Here's guys. Kyle Kirkwood, indeed, talking about RP Motorsports Racing. It was one of the highlights of last year's trip here to Toronto. Harrison Scott was upside down and flying into turn number three before he had even come to a stop, Nick Yeoman. The AMR safety crew was already there on the scene. There was a guy running before he even came to a stop. Another great show there for the AMR safety team, but also a show of the highs and lows of motorsports. Last year, RP Motorsports spent the weekend rebuilding race cars. This weekend, they're sipping champagne.
That's a cool story, no doubt about it, Rob. But congratulations to Kyle Kirkwood and that RP team. What a whirlwind 365 days it's been in terms of them coming up north racing here in Toronto. Aaron Tielitz, one of the drivers that we saw win yesterday, he runs in the sixth position. Not going to be a back-to-back win for him. We continue to watch that battle on fourth ahead of Tielitz between Norman and McGinnis, because McGinnis really hasn't allowed Norman to run away. But it is Oliver Askew who's up front with just six laps to go here on the streets of Toronto. Toby Sowery runs in the second spot. Dalton Kellett, all of a sudden, poised for a podium finish. He's getting kind of hounded right now by Rinus VK, who I imagine is seeing a little red mist, Kyle, considering he saw a race win thrown away. But still, this is potentially going to work out to be a great day for Dalton Kell at the podium finish.
Yeah, obviously that's a bright spot here for Juncos Racing, is that Dalton could get a podium in front of his home crowd. So it's going to be very exciting if he can hold on here for the next five laps.
It's been kind of a rough week or so for Juncos Racing. Watching the race down in Canadian Motorsports Park there in the IMSA series. A lot of repairs, I know, and we're all glad to see that such an awful-looking wreck there in that race, and certainly a torn-up race car for Juncos.
Yeah, it was terrible to watch, and I know Victor's a great guy and a great driver, so it was hard to see him in that scenario, but I was glad that he was able to walk away or, you know, be carted away and, you know, very minimal injuries in that scenario. So happy to see he's okay. I know he's here helping the Pro Mazda guys, yeah, coaching them. So great driver, great guy. And, you know, I know those guys are going to fight to get another car together and get back out racing.
Let's go back to pit lane. Five laps to go here in Toronto. Check in once again with Rob Howden.
Yeah, just a quick note, Nick, because I know that you and Kyle Kirkwood talked about it yesterday. If Oliver Askew gets to win this thing, I got to think there's probably going to be a pretty big party in Jupiter, Florida. You ask about what's in the water, but both Kyle Kirkwood and Oliver Askew from Jupiter, Florida, they got a chance both to win here this weekend. Could be interesting.
Yeah, it's fascinating. I wondered what exactly... seems as if those drivers are able to come out of Jupiter, Florida and be awful strong. Meanwhile, keeping an eye on that battle for fifth as Robert McGinnis is just all over Ryan Norman. Excuse me, that's the battle for the fourth position, separated by just a car length or two. Norman leads that train into turn at number five. We just saw moments ago Rinus VK, who has really kind of hounded Dalton Kellett, move over and let Norman and McGinnis go as well. Trying not to factor in these pretty good battles here in the closing stage of this race.
Yeah, that was great sportsmanship by him, knowing that there's two cars coming in hot with a battle. You know, best to just not get in the middle of that. You're four laps down, and it's kind of at the point now where cars do go out, he won't be able to make up a position. So he understands that, and getting out of the way was the right move.
Yep, five laps down right now to our race leader, Oliver Askew. It's going to be a big points hit, as we talked about, but still plenty of racing to go. Seven more races, a doubleheader in Mid-Ohio is what waits for the Indy Lights Series next. Then it's a trip to Gateway for one race on the oval there in the St. Louis area. Then we go to Portland, and we wrap the season up in Laguna Seca. Again, keeping an eye on that battle for the fourth position. Ryan Norman looks like he's pretty comfortable right now, Dave, first, but Robert McGinnis has been charging it a handful of times in the last few laps.
McGinnis did a very gentlemanly thing and let Norman get around him cleanly, but that has changed over time. McGinnis trying to reel in Ryan Norman.
Yeah, about a five-car length advantage. Ryan Norman looking more and more comfortable, and he starts to pull away now at the entrance of turn six.
And I'll tell you what, if Norman can get on that horse, he may threaten for this podium finish after all. He's trying to run down Dalton Kellett. Last time at the line, it was 2.1 seconds separating Kellett in third back to Ryan Norman in the fourth position. So, yeah, running out of laps with three to go, but certainly if Norman can get on it, he still has five opportunities, use that push to pass. Again, it was 2.1 seconds the last time across the line. This time we'll see it's right at 1.5 seconds. So all of a sudden, he is in that zone to maybe jump on that button. Let's take a look at that battle for third. Final step on the podium. Dalton Kellett trying to hold on in front of his home Canadian fans. But Ryan Norman, Dave, first, all of a sudden starting to charge.
How many Dalton Kellett t-shirts have we seen this weekend? He has a huge, huge fan base. About a four-car length advantage over Ryan Norman. The same back to Robert McGinnis.
Kellett knows he's there, for sure. He's starting to close little by little. McGinnis is the one that's having trouble to keeping pace. He really starts to fade now as they sweep their way through turn six.
Ryan Norman absolutely saw one on the steering wheel, and this is the part of the race, Kyle, where those Cooper tires, they have to be screaming a little bit, but Ryan Norman, he sees an opportunity to get a podium finish.
He is driving the heck out of that car right now. I love that they've had his in-car. Obviously, he had a problem earlier in the race going off, and you were mentioning that red mist. I feel like he's had that red mist this entire race. Every time I see his in-car, he is on top of those tires.
He's just got two laps to do it to try to run down Dalton Kellett. Meanwhile, Oliver Askew already making his way through turn number five. He and Toby Sowery have flat checked out on the rest of the field, but again, we're watching this battle for third as Ryan Norman continues to run down Dalton Kellett. It was 1.5 seconds. Dave, it's down to 1.1 seconds as they head to three.
So that push to to pass should come into play. It doesn't right now, though. Norman content to kind of hang by a single file. Robert McGinnis, about five car lengths back now.
Yeah, Kellett hitting all of his marks so far through turn number five. Same thing for Ryan Norman. However, a great run for Ryan Norman off of turn number four really closed the gap to the apex of five.
Yep, he's catching him, and we're going to keep an eye on it on this final lap. Meanwhile, Oliver Askew has seen the white flag. He will slip right through turn number two. It's been a perfect day. Avoided an accident in turn number three. Day first, he's headed to turn three for the final time with a race lead.
Yeah, awfully easy to get distracted here at Exhibition Place. The driver's left, a few hundred feet away. Boats as far as the eye can see. One of the playgrounds here, this part of the world. Oliver Askew, though, all business, trying to add to his resume here in Toronto.
Finished third in last year's Indy Pro 2000 Championship. That late season surge resulted in four podiums in the final six races, including his first win late in the year in the next to the last race before the season finale. Looks like he's headed to victory lane in Toronto.
Dave, here comes Ryan Norman looking for third.
Look to the inside, but not good enough to get around that UCOS machine of Dalton Kellett. Kellett maintains that podium position.
And Kellett's going to lead Norman out of turn number five. Up front, though, Oliver Askew clean out of turn number 11. He will see the checkered flag and score his fourth win of the 2019 Indy Lights season. Oliver Askew scores the victory in the Cooper Tires Grand Prix of Toronto presented by Allied Building Products. Toby Sowery comes home second. How about that battle for third? Dalton Kellett doing everything to hold on in front of the Toronto fans. Ryan Norman all over the rear wing through turn number 11. Both drivers sawing on that steering wheel, but Dalton Kellett gets a really nice run out of turn 11, and he'll score that podium finish for Humcos Racing. Congratulations to him. Ryan Norman will have to settle for the fourth position. Robert McGinnis comes home fifth. Aaron Tielitz looks poised to come home sixth. But it is Oliver Askew who scores the race win. And then maybe the quietest day of all, Toby Sowery, just a real quiet second place finish. But up front, great stories all about Kyle Kaiser.
Yeah, this played right into Oliver's hands. Obviously, this gives him a huge lead in the championship. So from here on out, he's just going to have to keep his consistency. He's been driving an amazing championship. And these are the types of days that really just help you out for getting that championship.
Askew salutes the fans down there in turn three. They are already filing in, getting ready to watch the NTT IndyCar Series a little bit later today for the Honda Indy Toronto. A big win, again, the fourth of the season for Oliver Askew. And that points lead now 25 markers over Rinus VK, who finishes ninth today. Ultimately, it's going to be a fantastic points day for Oliver Askew, because the three drivers that are kind of chasing him in the championship, they all fail to make it on the podium. As, again, Ryan Norman comes home in fourth, Robert McGinnis is fifth. Their points gaps right now, Norman is a good 53 points and 57 points for McGinnis behind Oliver Askew. So this really could be one of those weekends we look back and think, man, this is where Oliver Askew could have made a statement and win a championship. But certainly lots of racing to go. Still seven races in this championship. And some pretty cool racetracks too, Kyle, coming up. Mid-Ohio, the next opportunity for these drivers to compete.
Yeah, Mid-Ohio is a great racetrack. It's challenging, though, so I think it'll really push these drivers, and I think it'll be for some good racing.
Really enjoyed having you in the booth. This isn't your first time. You're no rookie to the IndyCar Radio booth. No doubt about it. Always do a fantastic job. For those that want to follow you on Twitter and follow your racing career, where can they do it?
Yeah, you can follow me at Kyle K Racing. Both my handles on Twitter and Instagram, and you know, hoping to get back behind the wheel of an IndyCar sometime soon.
And say hi to you when you're at the racetrack, because you're a pretty friendly guy, I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, I love chatting with the fans, and anybody that wants to come up, I'm always down.
Well, it's good to see you, and enjoy the rest of the weekend. What are you looking for the NTT IndyCar Series event a little bit later today? Simon Pagenaud on the pole. Got some interesting stories. Felix Rosenquist has been awful strong. It seems like that's going to be a fascinating race. It always is here.
Yeah, the Ganassi cars look really quick, but it's kind of been Pagenaud's weekend so far. So I think it's his race to lose at this point. But Rossi, I think he's going to be charging hard. He knows he made a mistake in that qualifying. I don't think he would have had the pace for pole, but I think he'll be our guy to watch for the race today.
Yeah, Lord knows when we let him win the pole, he usually checks out and wins by 30 seconds. So it's not going to be a factor. There's no doubt Alexander Rossi will see if he can win, although not starting on the front row. Meanwhile, his Andretti Autosport teammate, Oliver Askew has made his way to victory lane. We're going to hear from him momentarily as he is your race winner for the Cooper Tires Grand Prix of Toronto presented by Allied Building Products. Fourth win of the season, 25-point advantage, seven races to go. This thing is anything but over. Toby Sowery, though, a nice, quiet second-place finish, an uneventful day, Rob Blackman, but still one that's going to get him on the podium with a trophy.
I think that's a great point there, Nick Yeoman. Think about this. The man in car number two had a very quiet second-place finish, but second better than third. Talk to me about the run.
To be fair, it was a pretty boring race from my end. Had a good race with Dalton at the start, but then, you know, you can see the first three getting a bit of a gap over myself, so I thought I'd maintain the tyre and be there for the end, but Ollie's pace was just much quicker than mine, and unfortunately, Renus and Aaron crashed. So, you know, it's kind of gifted, but you can't complain.
Congratulations. Let's go to Rob Howden.
Standing by here with Oliver Askew, a huge win for him. Oliver, probably not the start you wanted. You started, of course, up front, but you end up getting pushed back a little bit. But you had to settle in and see what was going to happen. Obviously, it kind of played into your storyline. Big chug of water here. Give me your thoughts on that race and at least the start of it.
Yeah, for some reason I got a bad launch off the line, so unfortunately the first one was waved off and I got a good start then. So once those two got in front of me, they were battling and I just had a feeling that something was going to happen. So just was kind of pacing myself, saving my tires, and unlucky for them, but very happy for everybody on the Index Andretti Autosport car. This is my engineer Doug Zister's first win in his hometown of Toronto, so super happy for him. And let's go celebrate.
Well, you know how these things happen in this program too, USF F2000 Indy Pro. You've got to limit those mistakes, right? You guys, not any mistakes at all. 25-point lead now leading to Mid-Ohio. What's that make you think about?
Yeah, and the goal right now is just to win races, and then we can be conservative later. So biggest lead of the season so far. We're going to have to capitalize that on the next couple races. Andretti Autosport was really strong at the next couple tracks, so we're going to look to do the same.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Oliver Askew, Nick Yeoman, an impressive run for him. As he said, Doug Zister, his engineer, hometown boy, lives in nearby Kitchener, Ontario. Big for him to win here. Congratulations, of course, to Oliver Askew. But, man, it's all about limiting those mistakes. Tough one for Renus VK, but Oliver Askew, all smiles. Nick Yeoman.
Yeah, very cool. Doug Zister's been around in the Indy Lights Series for a very long time, too. So the hometown win, very cool for him and for everybody at Andretti Autosport. Big weekend for Dalton Kellett. Rob Blackman, Juncos Racing driver from right here in the Toronto area, comes away with a podium finish. Great job by him.
It was a great job, and the Toronto native, a podium finish. Talk to me about how special it felt to be on the podium here in your hometown.
I think this is one of the highlights of my racing career. You know, this is awesome. We've got all our friends and family and everyone out here today, and I can't thank them enough for being here, and this is probably one of my favorite races I've ever run. So, yeah, very, very ecstatic.
Now, unfortunately, let your teammate, Renus VK, you got in it with Tielitz with about 25 laps into the race, but that seemed to open the door for everyone else like yourself.
Yeah, you know, it's unfortunate that Renus had contact, and, you know, for Aaron to get taken out on a one-off event, you know, it's unfortunate for them both, but haven't seen the replay, so I can't comment on whose fault it was. I'm sure they both think it was each other. But no, it's, you know, that's too bad for the team, but we're definitely happy for the K-Line crew here.
One final question. Any guesstimate to how many family and friends were in the stands for you here today?
I think over the weekend, we've definitely got over 120 people here. I'm not sure about just today, but it's quite a few. You know, there's a sea of green walking around, and just like I said, I can't thank them enough for being here.
A sea of green celebrating a third-place finish. Congratulations.
Thank you.